Hey, I'm Tiffany Youngren, and today I'm going to share with you a conversation that I had with Ryan Carriere about the ins and outs and potential tax consequences when it comes to selling your apartment building or rental property on contract, meaning you're kind of like the bank. You're allowing the buyer to make payments over time and how that would affect you, some of the pros and some of the cons. We also cover a little bit about what to look for as a buyer. So Ryan Carriere is a CPA and senior tax advisor at Hall CPA, or also known as the Real Estate CPA. Ryan and his firm specializes in helping real estate investors maximize their tax savings from their rental portfolio. Ryan has worked with hundreds of real estate investors, and he estimates that he has saved his clients over $5 million in taxes over the last couple of years. So let's see what he has to say. So Ryan, thank you so much for being here. I tell everyone, and I tell you this all the time, but you are our favorite tax advisor. So I appreciate this, and I'm really looking forward to what you have to share with us today.
Yeah, thank you for having me, Tiffany. Always a pleasure speaking with you guys.
Today, you're going to share with us some of the top things that people who own apartments, multifamily, that they should consider or look at, the good and the bad and the ugly when it comes to selling on owner contracts. So can you share a little bit about what that means and some of the top tips or things to consider that you have in mind?
Yeah. I mean, the simplest one to start with would be basically if you're the buyer. If you're the buyer, as far as tax implications go, it really doesn't look very much different than a normal acquisition. So just on the buying side, very, very little to really speak on. You're basically just working more directly with the seller to kind of be the one who's financing it. Maybe you actually do kind of a split between getting traditional financing with the bank and maybe the seller finances part of it. That could always be the case. But really the conversation that we'll have is actually being the seller.
And because so, interest is interest. So exactly. As a buyer, if you're paying interest, you get, you know, the same benefit, whether it's to an individual person or a bank.
Exactly. And, you know, the bank might get you a better interest rate, or maybe there's a reason that you can't get the full amount of the loan that you need from the bank. Maybe there's something with your credit or something that you've maxed out other things. And so now you're getting a little bit more creative to kind of go to the seller to say, hey, can you finance some of this? Because I can't get traditional bank loans to basically acquire your property. And the seller might say, yeah, absolutely, we can be creative here.
And just on the flip side of that, I mean, there are so many reasons that a buyer might buy on contract. So I know for us, we actually can go out and finance our multifamily, but we love working with directly to seller. And I think that there's ways to benefit. So even interest rates, so sometimes we get better interest rates directly from the seller too. Okay. So having said that, I just want to put it out there. There are so many different reasons. But I appreciate you reminding everyone that interest is interest. So when it comes to taxes, it doesn't matter who you're paying.
It's all deductible. Yep. And that's kind of, I guess, the one of the tax aspects is it's all deductible. If it's interest related to that acquisition, it's all deductible. But yeah, for the seller, that is really where a lot of the benefit can come in. And so you can call it seller financing. In the tax world, we just call it a installment sale. When it's an installment sale, the gain, and when I say gain, there's all sorts of different types of gain. There's depreciation recapture gain. There's a long-term capital gain that I'm actually talking about. The long-term capital gain, right? So maybe you buy a property, they bought the property for $100,000 and they're selling it to you for $250,000. Okay. So yeah, if you're the seller, you've got that $150,000 gain. Essentially now, let's say that you've got a seller financed agreement with the buyer, and let's say it's just over 10 years, right? It can be whatever you guys make it. That's one of the nice things about being the seller and doing the seller financing is you can make the agreement however it's gonna be with that buyer. So say it's over 10 years, essentially, like to keep it simple, that $150,000 gain is going to be spread across over 10 years. Okay. So basically, now the benefit to you as the seller is you don't have to take all of that gain and move it into just the current year that you sell. Right. So instead of this huge spike in your income, now you're saying, hey, I'm taking that and I'm spreading that out slowly over the course of 10 years. Now, on top of that, as a seller, right, you're getting some interest. So now the interest that's coming to you, you've got this other form of income coming to you. Now that, as far as tax goes, that's just normal, ordinary interest income. Just like you put money in a savings account with a bank, it just comes to you at federal and state ordinary income tax rates, and that's it. That's really that simple. But now you get that source of income as well, okay? Now, obviously, the downside is, okay, well, is this you know, buyer actually going to fulfill the loan that I have with them? There's the risk there. And then two, are they going to default? And then I've got this, you know, property that's maybe in shambles for whatever reason. There's always a risk there. But at the end of the day, you've got the installment sale that's going to spread that out. And over the course of those 10 years, now you theoretically are going to pay less in tax because you're not hitting that maximum rate so quickly. Maybe you're keeping it in that long-term capital gain specifically. Maybe you're keeping that more in like the 15 instead of reaching up into that 20. Now, again, the downside though is, okay, I have to now finance this $150,000 or however much it is. I've got to finance that over 10 years. That's a long time to have my money be sitting there. So you need to justify, is the tax savings beneficial enough? And am I someone who wants that additional interest, right? If those two things aren't important to you, then maybe that's not even just a good strategy at all. So you got to think through obviously all the pros and cons. And obviously our conversation is primarily the tax. But here's the other thing I just wanted to come back to. That's a really nuanced thing that most people forget. If you go talk to a general CPA, they're generally not going to know this stuff. The main thing I just want to highlight is that when you have the sale that first year, let's say it's 2024, okay, what you're going to have when you sell a property, right, over the course of however long you've owned it, you have taken depreciation over the course of time. Okay. Now, depending on what you've done with the property, if you did, let's say, a cost segregation study, okay, if you did a cost segregation study, you've now got 5-year property, maybe some 7, you've got 15, and say it's a, you know, multifamily residential, 27 and a half years. You've got all these different buckets of depreciation that you've taken for this property. Now, again, the nuance I want to highlight with that is that the 5 and the 7-year property, you have to recapture all of that depreciation in the first year of sale. Okay. You don't get to spread that out. Okay. That's one of the unique nuances here is that if you've done a cost seg, you need to make sure you understand you're still going to recapture all that depreciation immediately. The other thing that you're going to recapture immediately is essentially the 15-year property. Okay. To keep it simple, there's kind of a nuance there with the 15-year property. That would be like land improvements, maybe the parking lot, for example. Okay. But basically, you're looking at your depreciation schedule. You're going to recapture everything that is essentially less than that 27 and a half year. That's all in this year, in 2024, in our example. We're not spreading that out. That is a common misconception that we find from generalist CPAs. The long-term capital gain that you can recapture over the course of 10 years. And then the last thing I just want to mention, that 27 and a half year property that you're depreciating very, very, very slowly, that is something that you can, yes, recapture slowly over the 10 years in our example. However, you are recapturing that first, okay? As you calculate your gain, you are recapturing that first, and then it's the long-term capital gain rate. So bottom line is remember that you're going to have depreciation recapture of probably something on that first year, even though you're doing this installment sale. And then second, just know that there's a little bit of like an ordering rule, kind of what we call in the tax world. Basically, what do you recapture first as part of your gain and in which year? So again, it's nuanced, and that's why people work with us. It's like, hey, this is kind of complex, and how do I calculate this? What is this going to be? But those are some of the nuances that I would want your audience to kind of be aware of. Any questions? Yeah, that you think?
Yeah. So by recapture, you mean we have to pay it back? Is that right? Okay. So I just want to kind of, in like regular people terms, like we're going to have to pay that back. And then can you? So when you said the 27 and a half year long term recapture. When you say you have to reorder it, what do you mean? Because like you have capital gains that you're going to pay taxes on slowly, and then you've got the recapture of the 27 and a half years. Like, what does it matter that it's ordered? I guess I don't understand what that means.
No, that's a good question. It matters because the maximum rate that your long-term capital gain is going to be at is 20%. The rate that 27 and a half year depreciation is going to be recaptured is at a max of 25%. So you've got a 5% difference there. Depending on how big your gain is, it might be very small. But basically, just people need to understand that, and they might be making estimated payments or something like that. And it might be off by 5%, right? And so now you've got an underpayment, or you've got this or that thing going on. And now you just kind of miscalculated what you're going to need in your account to maybe pay that final payment, something like that. So basically, it's just a difference in the tax rate of how that's going to get taxed. And so that's kind of the why that's important.
Okay, got it. So a lot of the people that we talk to about potentially selling their properties on contract, they've owned it for 10 years or so, and they're kind of like, don't even like, what do you mean cost seg? You know, so if someone were kind of in that position where they either own it outright or they've got, you know, a couple hundred thousand or a few hundred thousand left that they have owing on an apartment building, what would you say are the biggest advantages, assuming that someone like Dwayne and I are coming in and we have a huge track record of fixing up properties, so they know, oh, look, these people are going to buy it, they're going to fix it up, and it's going to be worth more. So yes. If it was a situation like that, if you were that person, what are some things that you'd be looking at? The same advantages would be, you know, that spreading out the capital gains, but what are some other things that they might be considering?
I would say that interest income. I think for a lot of people who are closer to retirement, they kind of want an additional source of that income. And they're like, hey, I don't need all these proceeds right now. What am I going to go do with it? Put it all in the stock market? Or maybe they want to consider acquiring another piece of real estate or something like that. But a lot of people, depending on where you're at in kind of your life, you might just be saying, this is kind of a source of income. And I can just kind of take, whether it's a few thousand or it's a few hundred dollars extra, just in the form of interest. Now you've got that. And you've got all of this kind of just coming from the sale, right? The long-term capital gain, you're kind of financing this. So you're kind of acting as the bank, getting that interest, but now you're slowly kind of getting those proceeds back. And you don't mind that, hey, if someone defaults, you get that property back and you can go try to sell it again.
Yeah,
and, exactly. And start that over. And especially for you guys, right? If you're going in and you're doing all this renovation, maybe they just kind of expect, hey, even if they default, I'm probably going to get a better property because they're spending all this time and putting in all this work. So yeah, basically I would think of it as you're maybe closer to retirement and looking to kind of get these additional passive sorts of income for you. And you want to have that additional interest income for yourself.
Got it. So I'm great at asking really stupid tax questions, which is why I really like talking to you all the time. But so if someone were looking at the difference between bringing in interest income and and rental income, are they taxed the same way?
Could be taxed differently. So if you are someone who, for example, doesn't meet real estate professional status, then your rental income is just going to be passive, right? Now, if you've got interest income from the interest on the seller finance note, that is just going to be ordinary income tax, and that's non-passive. That's a common misconception. Pretty much everything is non-passive, except for rental real estate. That's kind of the simplest way to say it, is in that order. So yeah, it's going to be non-passive, ordinary federal and state income tax, not subject to FICA tax, no self-employment, no Medicare tax. And same with real estate. Real estate, the rental profits are not subject to FICA tax as well. So they both don't have that. And the contrast there is if you're a W-2 earner or you're a business owner, right, you've got profits. Okay, you are paying that FICA tax, which is made up of Social Security and Medicare tax. So they're very similar. The only difference is really, are they passive for real estate or non-passive for that interest income?
Okay, so tell me again, if you are a real estate professional, rental income is or is not regular income?
It is regular income, and it would be non-passive if you're real estate professional status.
But if you're not, then it's passive.
Correct.
Just like interest. Or no, interest is ordinary income too. So.
Correct. And so here's kind of the unique thing too. So if you are, let's say, not meeting real estate professional status and you're getting rental profits, meaning, hey, all the income from my properties is, call it 200 grand. I've got total expenses, including depreciation, of, call it 180 grand. That gives you a total net profit of 20,000. If you're in that situation, again, most people aren't because they've got so much depreciation, that's kind of minimizing any sort of showing profit. But if you're kind of going with this example, 20,000 of profit, that would basically be taxed just like interest income. Okay. You still pay federal and state income tax. Again, still no FICA tax, but basically it is then taxed the same rate that your interest income would be in that example, because we're showing a profit. Correct.
Okay. Awesome. And I know it's quarter after, or it's a little like one minute late. So before we go though, and this, I feel like hopefully this conversation, like for me, it just breaks my brain. So I'm just like, I'm so glad that we'll just call you when the time comes, and then you can like map it out for us and everything. But why don't you tell everybody like how they can find you? Are you if they need a tax advisor, what would you recommend? What's a good starting place for that too?
Yeah. A couple ways you could find me. You can find me on LinkedIn, Ryan Carriere, CPA. I've posting pretty much every day, every weekday, about different tax strategies, tax advice, tips, things that we're seeing from IRS audits, things like that. So you can find me there. You can reach out to me directly and message me. Or my email for work is ryan.carrier@hallcpallc.com. You can reach out to me, tell me kind of where you found us or found me and say, hey, I'm interested. I'll get back to you and say, hey, you know, what do you have going on? Just to try to feel out if we're a good fit. We're not cheap. Just want people to know that we're kind of a specialty firm in real estate tax. So reach out if you're serious of kind of looking for a CPA, more than just someone to file your taxes, but looking for someone to actually strategize and understands this stuff and does this day in and day out.
And you have a podcast too.
Yes. Yeah. Tax Smart Real Estate Investors. I mean, it's on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, kind of all over. But yeah, Tax Smart Real Estate Investors. We just hit episode 300 yesterday. So kind of a big milestone for us. Yeah. And that comes out every Tuesday, every week. So yeah, tune in there. We're talking about all sorts of similar things to this and much more.
Awesome. And real quick. So, okay. And I should have looked this up before I came. I actually have been reading about this morning, but that Transparency Act that we're like bumping up right against that deadline. I know you guys, it's kind of an attorney thing, but you guys, I know, have just been like making sure that we know this is something to take care of, which I appreciate. What does someone do if they know they need to, like most people, they're like, I have an LLC, you know, it doesn't matter to me, but it's just a little one, but everybody has to do it if you have any kind of company. Is that true?
Pretty much. There are some very small exceptions. I think the actual like website you go to is fincen.gov/BOI. Don't quote me on that, but I believe that's what it is. But yeah, it's part of the Corporate Transparency Act. Basically, it's a beneficial ownership information form, hence the BOI acronym. But yeah, those are due if you have something, an entity created before 2024. Yeah, you want to get that done before December 31st, 2024. If you created an entity, new one this year, you had 90 days to complete that form. So it's kind of a new thing. The act has been in place, I think, for a couple of years now. But basically, they said now it's going into effect and we want to start gathering this information now kind of for 2024.
Well, there's our PSA. So awesome. Thank you, Ryan. Well, I appreciate your time so much. It's always great to talk with you.
Yeah. Thank you, Tiffany. And take care.
All right. Thanks. I think we can all agree that when it comes to scaling your business, it all comes down to who you know. If you want to know more about bringing key people into your life to help you move the needle even faster, be sure to ask me about the power of podcasting. I'd love to show you my white glove strategic guesting system and how it can help you scale your business, not only more quickly, but with a lot more fun, bringing more and more of the right people into your circle.